Well, today we're going to be talking about Carnap's paper, Empiricism, Semantics, and Ontology. Some people consider this the last gasp of logical empiricism. Even its opponents tend to treat it as an extremely important paper, and there is a fundamental distinction that it introduces that has become part of, you might say, a common currency philosophically. And so it's a useful thing to be exposed to and to think through, even if in the end you think Carnap is wrong. Now, there are a lot of people, on the other hand, who think Carnap is actually getting at something deep and important here. And there is a philosophical strategy that emerges in this paper that I think is really important independently of the way that he in particular applies it. One way of putting it is this. Suppose we're interested in a certain concept or set of concepts, and we're trying to analyze what that's all about philosophically. Carnap's point, in a way, is just that we should approach it in the following fashion. Think about a language which did not have that set of terms or the ability to express those concepts, and think what would have to be added to give that language the ability to include those terms or express those concepts. And so the way of thinking about it isn't exactly analysis in the more traditional sense in which the early writers in this tradition, like Bertrand Russell, or G.E. Moore, or even Wittgenstein, were thinking. Instead, it's something like, think about what it would be like not to speak a language in which we could talk about propositions, for example, or in which we could talk about mental entities, or in which we could discuss abstract entities, and think what resources would we have to add to that language to be able to do that. So he's not approaching this from the point of view of X is a number, if and only if, can we translate that into something else. He's instead saying, imagine a language where we have no way of expressing numbers. What would we have to add to the language in order to be able to express, talk of numbers? Now you might say, well, numbers. Okay, and so you might think this has a very dumb sort of answer to it. And so to make it interesting, you could say, well, what's the smallest set? Or what are the smallest sets of resources we could add that would actually allow us to accomplish this? Also, another way of thinking about this is to say, well, yes, in some sense, obviously, we could just add talk about numbers. But what we're interested in a sense, is what kind of move is made when we make that transition? If you make the jump to number talk, what exactly are you doing? And sometimes it's surprising how little has to be added. So we've been discussing this idea of frameworks. And this is the paper which really starts thinking about things in terms of frameworks. A framework in which we can discuss propositions, for example, or mental states, or numbers, or other abstract objects, such as properties and relations. And we think, what does it take to add such a framework? Carnap starts out with a pretty bold claim. He says, here's what it takes. It takes something that is a term that talks about the things of this general category. So, if we say, you know, yeah, actually, let me write down what I was saying just a moment ago. Think about a language or a framework, if you want to keep it more general, in which we can't discuss X, whatever that is, and then ask the question, what would we have to add to have that capacity? To obtain the ability to discuss things of this kind. And his answer is twofold. He basically says, first of all, we would have to add some term that covers things of the relevant kind. So a term like, for example, proposition, or property, or number, or whatever. So just a term covering the general category, because after all, if we can't do this, presumably we can't actually, we don't already have such a term, and we're going to need one. But then what else? Well, this is the surprising part. We just have to add variables for such things. For propositions, for properties, for relations, for numbers, for mental states, or something like that. And that's really all we have to do. So it turns out that introducing a framework for discussing a kind of entity, he says, is actually a pretty simple thing. Okay? Just introduce a term and some variables for that kind of thing. Now let's start with something dumb. We don't tend to talk about witches anymore. But suppose we were to start doing that again and said, okay, what would it take to introduce into our current framework a framework where there are witches? Or maybe if that, since that used to be, maybe a better example would be something from the Harry Potter world, okay, where it's really just, what's something that's distinctive to Harry Potter?
Muggles.
Muggle, well, yeah, but you and I are Muggles. I mean, Muggles is just sort of ordinary person, right? So that's easy to translate, but Dementors, right? Okay, there isn't just sort of this old view about Dementors. It's like that's specifically introduced by J.K. Rowling. So, okay, we might be puzzled about how to actually do an analysis of Dementor if we're thinking in terms of reducing that to something else. X is a Dementor if and only if what? You might say, yeah, I don't know how to do it that way. But what is it to introduce into a conceptual framework this concept, this ability to talk about Dementors? Well, you need the term Dementor and variables that will include Dementors. The end, okay? Then you might think, well, wait a minute, that's all? I mean, that's kind of trivial. That's sort of, gosh, what do I need to talk about X? Oh, the term X. Right, and some things that it could apply to, some variables that it could apply to. But actually, the analysis is more interesting than that. So let's see how it goes with respect to propositions, for example. What does it take to introduce the framework of propositions? Now, we get back up, and before we really get to this, think, what is a proposition supposed to be? Philosophers have talked about propositions or something like that ever since ancient times. But now, what is a proposition, exactly? So, suppose we started, we'll start in a traditional form. We'll think, let's do an analysis of the kind that Russell or Moore might have had in mind. What is a proposition? What's the relationship between a sentence and a proposition?
Something a sentence signifies.
Good, it's something a sentence signifies or expresses, right? So one thing we can say is, okay, sentences express or signify propositions. You want to say them. Okay, what else is true of propositions as traditionally conceived?
They have a truth value.
They have a truth value, yeah. So they bear truth values. And what else? There's really a third thing that I think is part of the traditional conception. Well, you can have attitudes with respect to them, right? You can believe them. You can know them. You can doubt them. You can wonder whether they're true. You can, maybe you can fear them. I fear that it will continue raining. I didn't bring my umbrella. Or you could have other kinds of attitudes, presumably, toward them. So they are objects of attitudes. Now you might look, there is nothing that actually has all three of those properties. And so some people doubt that there are propositions just because they think actually those are three different functions. Why should I be sure that any one person fulfills all those functions? You might think, gosh, I would like to have somebody landscape my yard and fix my plumbing and install some lights. Okay, so I need a landscaper, plumber, electrician, right? I'm looking for somebody who fulfills all three of those. And it might be that nobody does that. You've got to have three different people doing those three different tasks. So it's a non-trivial philosophical assumption underlying this that there is one kind of entity that does those three things. But let's put that aside for a moment. That's sort of how to think about this from a traditional point of view. Now, from Carnap's point of view, how do we think about it? Well, we think, what is actually required to introduce this framework of propositions? Imagine that we have a language where we don't discuss them at all. Maybe we talk about sentences. Maybe we just say things about the world. And then we introduce this idea of propositions. And so here's one way to introduce it. Say, here's what a proposition is. But another way would simply be to introduce this linguistic framework. And so, what does he say about this? Well, if we want to talk about propositions, what we do is, let's see, where does it start? Okay, we introduce the general term proposition. So we need a term. In this case, it is indeed just proposition. And then what? Well, we have to have a style of variables. And so we'll introduce something like P is a proposition. So we have a certain style of variables here that makes that possible. But now, actually, there's one more thing. He says, the general term proposition is introduced. P as a proposition may be defined. So the third thing that we actually add is something like a definition. But it's a definition of a surprising kind. It doesn't look very much like that sort of definition. Instead, he says, we do it in the following way. We say P is a proposition, maybe defined by P or not P. And so here's how that ends up going. P as a proposition is just defined as P or not P. And that enables us to introduce the framework of propositions. Now there's something important about this, because what happens here is we get something, he says, that notice is analytic. It's analytic whether P or not P. Chicago is large or Chicago is not large. Yeah, that seems like a logical truth. So that Chicago is large is a proposition. We have to cheat there a little bit. Notice I have to introduce the word that in saying that Chicago is large is a proposition. But I substitute other things for P that are inappropriate for the variable and won't work out. Like Fred or not Fred. That doesn't make any sense. Molecule or not molecule. That doesn't make any sense. Between or not between. That doesn't make any sense. So I have to have the right kind of thing going in here. It has to be a sentence, for example. But his point is this. If I've got sentences in my language, then it actually doesn't take much to introduce talk of propositions. All I have to do is have a term proposition, some variables that can range over propositions, and then introduce a way of making sense of that. So with the dementor example, I would introduce the term dementor, have a variable for that, let's say D is a dementor, but then I do have to actually give some kind of characterization of it. But notice in this case, it's not this kind of definition. It's something that has a sort of surprising feature. What happens is that I take something that wasn't functioning as a singular term, and I turn it into one. So here, the thought is supposed to be a little bit different. I am actually taking predicates that I can make sense of, and then using those to characterize what a proposition is. Here, I'm actually just taking something of a different grammatical category and allowing it to play a new role. Okay? So, Chicago is large, or Chicago is not large, but then, well, in English we signify that by putting in the word that. That Chicago is large is a proposition. I've taken something that was functioning just as a sentence, and I've turned it into something that can function as a singular term, referring to an object, in this case a proposition. Okay, so if that's the general strategy, then what kind of thing can we do with other sorts of terms? So let's think about properties. Are there such things as properties in the world? Think about this in a big Platonic sense. Are there such things as forms? Plato says you and I are really just shadows of the form of personhood. And these desks are really just shadows of the form of deskhood. that feels really dense. But some of these things, you sort of think, okay, that's sort of the overall picture. Now, whether you think this shadow business works or not, you could think, well, look, we do talk about properties, such as, well, being a desk or being a person, personhood. There's a big debate about personhood and what that is and what it covers in ethics, for example. But we can talk about properties in all sorts of other ways. We can worry about triangularity or justice. And so those are things that seem to be, well, talk about properties of various kinds. Now, what does it take to introduce talk of properties? Well, from this point of view, it's not so surprising. First of all, we introduce the general term property. So we have a way of talking about these things. Secondly, we introduce a new style of variable. So let's let that be, I don't know, maybe capital T to be a style of variable that we'll use for properties. And then we have to say something about what a property is. So we define P is a property to be the same as, now what? The whole point of this strategy is not then to give a sort of definition in the standard way, but instead to take P and use it in a different grammatical role where it's not a singular term. So how could we do that?
Is a set?
Well, we could do it that way. We could think, let's represent P as a set of objects that have the property, for example. And that's a very Russellian or even Freudian way of thinking about this. But actually, Carnap has in mind something different, because that's a way of taking an object that we've already constructed and identifying it with this. And notice what Carnap did here. He didn't construct an object and say that object is a proposition. He just said P is a proposition if and only if P or not P. He didn't build up an object. Instead, now, later, by the way, people think of propositions in different ways. For example, as sets of possible worlds. So they're using your strategy. They're building up an object and saying, let's call that a proposition. That's not what he's doing. He's really just taking something and allowing you to use things as singular terms without building an object. And so you might say there's this traditional strategy of construction that he was concerned with earlier in the logical structure of the world that Russell was pursuing in logical atomism. Notice, this is not constructive. He's not actually constructing an object and saying, aha, now we have something that can play the role of a proposition or a property or something like that. Instead, he's just sort of, well, pulling what feels like a logical trick, right? Allowing you to use something as a singular term that wasn't used as a singular term. So, one way to do this would be to construct a set, something of that sort, but his strategy in this paper is different. The earlier Carnap would have done just what you're saying. But Carnap at this stage says, actually, there's a different way of doing it. Now, think about a property like justice. Okay? Justice is a property, if and only if. And now, what do we have in our language already that isn't an abstract term like justice, but nevertheless might apply to individual objects or individual events, or occurrences or actions?
You could say P is a property if an object has or doesn't have it.
Yeah, if it has or doesn't have it. But that's already to use it as a singular term, so to say that an action has justice, for example, what's a simpler way of saying that?
An act is just.
Is just, exactly. So, if PX or not PX. Okay, so justice is a property if and only if, well, for any X, X is just or X is not just. Triangularity is a property if and only if, well, X is triangular or X is not triangular. Notice what happens here. There we have that sort of acting as the thing in English that signals a singular term. Here what happens, well, we have something that signals this. It's like turning triangle into triangularity, or just into justice, or kind into kindness, etc., etc. There are all these ways of putting on a suffix that turns something into an abstract term. And that's an indication that we've done this, and we're now using this as a singular term. But he says, don't think that singular term has to refer to something. Instead, just think, well, we're building it up from a predicate. And we're doing it by adding this and allowing it to play the role of a singular term. But nothing philosophically huge is going on there. Now, there are two ways of taking this. One way of taking Carnap's general strategy here is to say he's a nominalist, and he's giving you the key to nominalism. He's saying you can talk about justice or triangularity or propositions without committing yourself to abstract objects. You can think everything in the world is just a particular thing that is triangular or is not triangular, that is just or is not just, that is true or not true, or something like that, and then add this abstract language without really any ontological commitments. And a lot of people have interpreted Carnap that way. But actually, Carnap himself seems to say, what I'm doing is showing that this question of nominalism is actually not a very interesting question. So he doesn't see himself, I think, as pursuing a strategy of nominalism here, but instead of saying the whole traditional debate about realism, conceptualism, nominalism, and so on, is based on the idea that there's a real metaphysical question here. And there isn't. Why? What are we doing? We're introducing a framework like this. And now we can distinguish two kinds of questions. There are internal questions. Questions that are internal to a framework. Like, let's say within the framework of propositions, we ask, are there propositions? Well, within this framework, what's the answer to that question? Sure, right? Are there propositions? Well, all that means is, yeah, is there a P such that P is a proposition? So is there a P such that P or not P? Is there a sentence such that it's true or not true? Yeah, sure. And so the answer is always a sort of trivial yes. Or no. I mean, if the framework is not one that includes that, maybe. But normally, it's just a trivial yes. Of course. If you ask the person teaching you, let's say you're in first grade, the teacher is teaching you some basic arithmetic. You're counting, right? You're saying 1, 2, 3, 4. And then you get complicated things like 1 plus 1 is 2. And you say, I have a question, Miss Walters. Are there really numbers? What's Miss Walters going to say?
Sure.
Right, exactly. Yeah, like 1 is a number, right? 2 is a number. So sure there are numbers, like 1, 2, 3. And it's a kind of trivial question, right? If you say, are there even numbers that are greater than 100? She's going to say, sure, like 102, 104, etc., right? If you say, are there any numbers at all? Sure, 1, 2, 3. It's a trivial question. Are there any propositions? Sure, that 1 plus 1 is 2, that Chicago is large, right? That I'm now speaking to you. And so within the framework, this is very simple. Are there propositions? Well, sure. Similarly, are there properties within the framework of properties? Sure. Yes, and notice that in this case, it's just analytic, he says, that's true. It's just analytic that there are properties. It is analytic that there are propositions. Why? Because it's analytic that P or not P. It's analytic that PX or not PX. And so within the framework, these are utterly trivial questions. But now suppose we're not in the framework. Suppose we say, yeah, but look, I'm not asking that kind of question. Right? Miss Walters says, of course there are numbers, 1, 2, 3. You say, no, I'm asking a deeper question. Numbers are abstract objects. I want to know if there are abstract objects. Miss Walters, what's your position on the realist, conceptualist, nominalist debate? Then I think Miss Walters sends you to the principal. But it could be that she said, well, you want to ask a deeper question. Well, there is a deeper question here, right? And that is the external question. But it's not really the metaphysical question either. The external question is just, should we adopt that framework? The framework of propositions, the framework of properties, the framework of numbers. And so from that point of view, the right way to answer this deeper question the first grader has is to say, well, sure, there's numbers like 1, 2, 3, and 4, and if you're asking why we should do arithmetic at all, why we should accept any of that, the question is because arithmetic's really useful, okay? It's important that we actually be able to count things, that we be able to add numbers together and do other kinds of things. And in short, what Ms. Walters has to do is defend the utility of arithmetic. But notice that when she's doing that, she's not giving some metaphysical argument. She's just saying, look, pragmatically, it's really useful to introduce this framework of numbers and talk about numbers. So this sort of question ends up being analytic and trivial. This sort of question is just pragmatic. It's just a matter of thinking, well, is it worth adopting that framework? It has advantages. It has some disadvantages, right? As the first grader is learning arithmetic, you may be painfully aware of the disadvantages of introducing this framework. You have to learn all this stuff and count stuff and learn the rules of addition and multiplication and blah, 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 right? And so there can be all sorts of pragmatic arguments for and against a certain framework. For example, introducing this framework of propositions. What are some advantages of introducing this framework of propositions? The external question here isn't the simple one, are there propositions? Oh, of course, Chicago's large or not large, so that Chicago's large is the proposition. It's instead to say, what's the value of introducing that talk of propositions? And now we can think about positive and negative consequences. So what are some positive things that happen if we introduce this framework of propositions? Why do people talk about propositions? And not just talk about sentences. After all, that Chicago is large is different from just, quote, Chicago is large. What's the advantage of moving from that to talk of propositions?
Convenience in language, it's just easier.
Okay, it is easier. Now, why is it easier? What does it let us do easily that otherwise would be kind of hard to do?
Evaluate the truth of something.
Evaluate the truth. Well, let's see. I say Chicago is large. And you think, I don't know how to think about that. But if I think, is it true that Chicago is large? Oh, no, I see.
And how do you know you're actually talking about what we connotate Chicago as currently? Or, you know, it's not really meant to denote something else.
Well, there... yeah. Okay, good. That's an interesting point. Because when I talk about the sentence, Chicago is large, I'm just talking about a set of marks, right? Or maybe a type of mark or a type of... I mean, it's actually kind of complicated to figure it out because it can be written down, it can be spoken, etc. But it's a syntactic object of some kind, or maybe a phonological object of some kind, or some combination of those. But as soon as I say that Chicago is large, you do get the sense that now I'm talking about this as interpreted, right? And now the referent of Chicago seems relevant and the referent of large. So you're right, both of those are actually vague. Chicago, do you mean the city boundaries, or do you mean the metropolitan area? Do you mean in population? Do you mean in geographical area? What Chicago denotes there may seem vague, but also large, they can seem vague. Actually, not only between geographically large and large in population, but there's a lot of vagueness to large, right? Is Austin a large city? Yeah. I don't know, it's kind of large. Actually, this was a better example 20 years ago. Then it was kind of large. Now it sort of just is large.
Houston, a large city.
It's Houston,
yeah.
A large city.
Yeah.
There, I think you can just say, yeah, sure, maybe, right? But what are some cities that might be on the borderline of this? Where you say, is that large? And you say, oh, I don't know. Kind of, sort of.
Perth, Australia.
Perth, maybe, I don't... Good, yeah, take an obscure city that I don't know. Sorry for those Australian viewers. But yeah, I don't know much about Perth, Australia, you might be right.
Small city.
Yeah, I mean, there are some cities where very clearly we say, no, it's not large, right? I say, oh gosh, what's... Salt Flat, Texas, population 10, is a large city.
No, it is really not. It's not a city then.
It's not really a city at all. That's true. City is vague in addition to the vagueness of large. So what counts as a city? You might think, yeah, in fact, in that sense, what is a city but a large population center? And so you might Somebody might say, it's just analytic that cities are large, because otherwise we wouldn't call them cities. But presumably, there can be small cities, like Akron, Ohio, maybe, or maybe like Perth, Australia, or, Sioux City, Iowa, or something like that, where you say, look, it's a city. It's called Sioux City, so it's got to be a city. but it's a small city. Yeah.
Well, large probably means like large of its type, right? And you say
good. It does mean large for a city, right? So yeah, city is sort of already large for a population center, but then a large city is large for a city, so it's large for a large population center. Yeah, exactly. So there are really two senses of large there. Now, notice that if we're just talking about the sentence Chicago is large, we don't necessarily have to get into this, but the moment we talk about propositions, you might think all of this becomes relevant. What proposition are you expressing? You say Chicago is large, and now we can say, what do you mean? Whereas if I just say, consider the sentence, single quote, Chicago is large, you could think, okay, that's clear, I know what you're saying, right? To say what that expresses, that's where all this vagueness and ambiguity, et cetera, come in. So one thing we could think happens here is we've now got something that has real semantic import. Now, the sentence has a semantics, too. We could interpret it. You might think an act of interpretation has already gone on when we move to the proposition. Now, something like Chicago is large shows us this because there are these levels of ambiguity introduced. Another classic case of this, which shows the utility, is something that involves a pronoun. I say, I wonder whether it's raining. And you think, Dan wonders whether it's raining. And there's a sense in which we're both expressing the same proposition. Those are two different sentences. I've said, I wonder whether it's raining. You've said, he wonders whether it's raining, or Dan wonders whether it's raining. And yet we want to say all of those express the same proposition. Now, what are some other advantages besides getting away from the difficulty of the I in that sense? By the way, some people have argued that the traditional concept of omniscience attributed to God is incoherent. Because I can know that I am wondering whether it's raining, but God can't know that I am wondering. God knows that Dan Bonnevac is wondering, let's say, if God knows everything, but God can't know it in this de-say personal way that I do. Now, yeah, I think this is a laughable objection, but one way of arguing that it's a laughable objection is to say, look, to say that God is omniscient means God knows all the propositions. It doesn't mean God knows I am hungry when I am hungry, right, etc. So, yeah, it seems silly. But introducing the term proposition can be a way of seeing why that's a silly objection. By the way, people have actually talked about this at the American Philosophical Association meetings, which is why if you ever think, whoa, I bet that is a forum for deep and wise thinking. It's not always true. Most of the time not true. Now, so it gives us that advantage. What are some other advantages? It allows us to abstract away, in other words, from indexicals and demonstratives like this and that and other things that introduce a kind of context dependence. And so allows us to talk about what's being said or what's being thought without being tied to a specific context. And that can be really useful. Are there other things that are like that, taking it out of a context? Suppose we speak different languages. And so I say, that is red. And a German speaker says, das ist rot. We're expressing the same proposition, right? And yet using two very different sentences in different languages to express the same proposition. You might say, gosh, we're thinking the same thing, we're saying the same thing, even though we're speaking different languages. Can you see other advantages of talking about propositions? Actually, that's a big one when you think about objects of attitudes. Because suppose the German speaker has that belief that would be expressed by that sentence, and I have the belief expressed by the sentence in English. Are we believing the same thing or different things? If we're talking about propositions as objects of belief, we can say we're believing the same thing. And we can easily express that using this language of propositions. In sentences, what would we have to do? We'd have to say, well, the German speaker has a relation to that sentence, and I have a relation to this sentence, and then those sentences are intertranslatable or mean the same thing or something. So maybe we could say that, but it's a lot more complicated to say that. Are there other advantages to introducing an abstract term like proposition? Well, let's turn it around and ask the other question. Are there disadvantages? What would be an argument pragmatic against introducing talk propositions or properties or other abstractions like this?
I mean, it kind of just like sets sentences into like either being true or false, so I feel like that kind of takes away from what a sentence could actually mean.
Oh, well, all right, yes, it does abstract away from the details of the individual sentence. Mm-hmm. And at times, that can be an advantage, but at times you might be losing information that matters. For example, I ask whether John believes that the morning star is the evening star, and you happen to know that those actually refer to the same object. Now, is that proposition the same as the morning star is the morning star? Ask John, is the morning star the morning star? Sure. Is the morning star the evening star? Ooh, I don't know. And so, now we might say, in this case, it matters what sentence is being used, but depending on our view of propositions, we could end up saying, but those things express the same proposition. And so it would be a mistake to move away from the sentences in that case and move to talk of propositions. Now here, are we committed about the identity conditions of propositions? When is P the same proposition as Q? Notice this doesn't really say anything about that. We don't really have identity conditions here. After all, P or not P is equivalent to Q or not Q in the sense that they're both just logical truths. So we can't very easily introduce identity conditions here and get a good answer to the question of whether the morning star is the morning star and the morning star is the evening star express the same proposition as the propositions. Now, in a way that's good, we aren't committed to a bad consequence here, but from another point of view, you might say there's something that's really ill-defined here. And the same truth of this is triangularity, the same property as trilaterality. Having three angles, having three sides. Are they the same property or different properties? Well, things have three angles or not. Things have three sides or not. We don't really get an answer to that question, right? There are different P's that go in there. So I suppose you could say that's an argument that there are different properties. Just as here, the morning star is the morning star, and the morning star is the evening star are different sentences, so maybe that's an argument that they're different properties. But we got to be careful because we want I'm hungry and Dan is hungry, or I'm wondering whether it's raining and Dan's wondering whether it's raining, to actually express the same proposition. So this, in a sense, doesn't commit us with respect to identity conditions, and that can be dissatisfying. I mean, Quine at one point introduces the slogan, no entity without identity. And we don't have identity conditions yet. So Quine will be unhappy. He'll say, I don't know whether that's the same proposition as that, whether this is the same property as that, whether there are one or infinitely many possible fat men in the doorway, et cetera, because possibilities might be something introduced along similar lines. And so, in short, there might be that kind of disadvantage. Are there other disadvantages we might have to worry about? Losing information is one, in other words, and this lack of identity conditions is another closely related one. Are there other disadvantages? Yeah?
Well, kind of going along with the like losing information one, I'm in another linguistic anthropology class, and we're just talking about linguistic relativity, where it's like, because people aren't speaking the same language, like, even though you're saying the same thing, you still have a different kind of meaning associated with it, even though it's like relating to referencing the same thing. So kind of you're losing that level of information also.
That's a good point. You might think that the kind of information being conveyed really does depend on the rest of the linguistic framework. And it's not clear, especially insofar as we're now able to identify things across linguistic frameworks, you might worry that we're losing a certain kind of context. So if this could happen in a kind of anthropological setting, where, for example, we have a very rich set of color words, we go to study a tribe's language, and we realize they only have, let's say, three color terms. They divide the whole spectrum up into just these three things. And the question is, well, how do we translate those words that they use? Here's one proposal. they are white, black and red. Okay? Here's another proposal. Well, they're really red, yeah, but the others are more like light and dark. Because after all, what we would describe as brown, for example, they're going to call black. And so you might worry about how we sort of capture the content of this proposition. And that's, so there's that worry. There's also this kind of worry in a scientific context with theory change. We move from traditional Newtonian mechanics to relativistic mechanics, and all of a sudden, do we have the same concept of kinetic energy or a different concept of kinetic energy? Does kinetic energy really function as the same term there, or should it be viewed differently? Is it, if we think of it as an abstract property that something has, is it the same property or a different property? And so I think you're right that, in a sense, it may be good that this doesn't commit us to a specific view of that, but you might think, look, there's a tension here, because insofar as we gain the advantage of pulling things out of their context, we get the disadvantage that we're losing information provided by that context, right? And we've got to, I mean, in some cases, it's super easy to put in that information. I am hungry away from the speaker. I don't know who it is anymore, but I can fill that in with a proper name designating the person who's hungry and problem solved. But in a case like the one you're describing, the whole question is, in a sense, what term would I substitute? And it might be really hard to do that. This is the kind of worry, actually, that's going to lead Quine to one of his most dramatic theses that we'll study later in the course, which is the thesis of the indeterminacy of translation, where even in pretty simple cases, he's going to argue, it's not at all clear how we should translate native utterances, partly because of this question of conceptual schemes that don't match up precisely, but partly because when it comes to basic metaphysical questions, he's going to say there's no real content to the idea of, let's say, running into a tribe, all of whom turn out to be Platonists, or another tribe that are thoroughgoing nominalists. And he'll say, you know, I can't tell the difference between these tribes. And so there's something unintelligible about that, in a way that finding a tribe with a different set of color concepts isn't absurd. That really could happen. But to say, oh, we've discovered this tribe of Platonists, that he thinks is absurd. Even though intuitively you might think, but go back to Plato's Academy in the old days, and isn't that a tribe of Platonists right there? I mean, well, anyway, never mind. We'll get to that soon enough. But yes, there's one last. Anyway, I think that's a critical point. Insofar as we gain flexibility to use this independently of context, linguistic context, cultural context, context of the speaker, the time, et cetera, all of those things are going to be, in a sense, abstracting away from certain information we might care about. The last one is, we have to learn this, right? And not only is there that kind of burden, we have to learn to speak propositionese or propertyese and so on, but it can mislead us. Now, what's potentially misleading about it? We've got all of these things functioning as singular terms, and it looks like they're referring to objects. But are they really referring to objects? Not really, right? I mean, this just translates as P or not P. That's not referring to an object. Justice is a property. That just translates into X is just or X is not just. So actually, these are kind of pseudo singular terms. They're not really referring to an object. They're doing something else. Now, notice this has an implication, which is part of the reason Quine hates it. Because one question to ask here is, why does Quine find this so objectionable? Why do he and Carnap get into a big debate about all of this? Part of it is because this really undermines Quine's criterion of ontological commitment. Remember, he said to be is to be a value of a variable. And so, once I've done this, notice I can existentially quantify with respect to this. I can now say there are propositions. In fact, there's a proposition that both you and I believe. We can say all sorts of things like this. And similarly here, we can say, sure, there is a P, such that P is a property. Namely, for example, justice, or triangularity, or redness, blah, blah, blah. Of course, those things are analytic. And so there is a P, such that this is the case. That's going to be a trivial truth. And yet, Carnap's point is, that doesn't actually commit me to an object like justice or triangularity or redness. Why? Because all I'm really doing is abstracting away from usages like this. And so the big conclusion of, well, I think there are a number of big conclusions of this. Let's spell them out explicitly. One is, to be is not to be a value of a verb. In fact, we might say, variables are cheap.
Can I ask on that, the reason for that is because there are things that are values of variables that don't really exist. Is that the argument?
Well, yeah, that, well, actually, yeah, you're right. I mean, maybe the value here is that, because in a sense, we can talk about there being properties without actually having any properties as values of variables. So maybe, actually, I'm putting it in a misleading way. A better way of putting it would really be that existential and universal quantifications are not good guides to ontology. So let me put that more precisely. And now I'm running out of room, aren't I? Well, I'll get rid of properties here like a good novelist. And so we could say a better way of putting that really is quantification is not the guide to ontology. And the second big implication is really just that if we ask these basic ontological questions, are there properties, are there propositions, are there numbers, etc., really, they're either trivial, if they're internal questions, or they're pragmatic. So, so-called metaphysical questions are either trivial, if they're internal, or practical questions, if they're external questions. There is no deep metaphysical question. Are there numbers? Are there propositions? Are there properties? Are there relations? Are there mental states? Blah, 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 right? All of those end up, Carnap thinks, being either trivial questions if asked within the framework. We've introduced the framework of numbers. Are there numbers? Sure. 1, 2, 3, 4, right? Oh, you mean the external question? Then it's a practical question. Is it worth doing arithmetic? Is it worth talking about propositions? Is it worth talking about properties?
Yeah. In that way, could Pegasus become a pragmatic object?
Ooh, suppose we talk, well, for one thing, Pegasus doesn't give us something of a new kind, really, in the sense that we have to now introduce a new kind that forces us to change grammatical categories. But if we introduce a category of dementors or of Pegasus, the question is, in a sense, well, I'm telling you the story about Pegasus, right? Bellerophon rode him, he was white, he was winged, he did this and that. Within the myth, of course, Pegasus exists, right? If I ask the external question, it's really to say, so is this myth something we should accept? And the same thing would be true of the dementors. Within the story of the Harry Potter world, of course there are dementors. But you say, oh, do they really exist? You're saying, should we accept this myth or this, you know, Harry Potter world as reality? And then, for all sorts of practical reasons, we shouldn't. We'll go around looking for dementors, we'll fear them, we'll think we have to come up with a Patronus, and none of that's true.